Hi, everyone. Thanks so much for the opportunity to speak to you today. It's a real privilege to do so. My name's Chris Stark. I'm the chief executive of something called the Climate Change Committee. We are a public body that was established in 2008 by the UK's Climate Change Act. So that's the law that we have on climate change for the whole of the UK. And that gives us the task of acting as the independent advisors to government on climate change, also as the watchdog to Parliament on our progress towards the targets that are in that piece of legislation. About a year after the UK's Climate Change Act, Scotland made its own Climate Change Act. So 2009, that came along. And that gave us a similar role in Scotland. So we're the advisor to the Scottish Government on climate change, also the watchdog for Holyrood. And you might know that it was our advice in 2019 that led to the setting of the net zero target in Scotland. I'm also a Scot, so I live in Glasgow where I'm recording this today, and I used to work for the Scottish Government before I took this job. I now lead a team of analysts, there's about 30 or 40 of us, and what we're trying to do is to build a detailed view of how we can decarbonise the whole economy. So we think about all the things that you've been thinking about, electricity generation, transport, heat, industry, land use, farming, all the things that you've been discussing in the past few weeks. It's my job to try and establish pathways to the legal targets that we have, and then to try and build advice on the kind of steps and policies that might be necessary to drive progress along that path. And it's great, I have a brilliant job. We do all of that independently, as I mentioned. We don't work for the government, so what you get from us is a genuinely independent view. Now, we've just published a brand new assessment of how the UK and Scotland can meet its statutory targets on time. And that's mainly what I'm going to talk about today. The Scottish target, as you will know better than anyone, is for net zero by 2045. That's earlier than the UK net zero goal of 2050. But they're actually the same target. So if I put it another way, the UK is going to struggle to meet its 2050 target if Scotland doesn't get there sooner. And that's because Scotland has greater potential than the rest of the UK to store carbon, especially in the natural environment, in the soils and in the trees. So the headline today is that we can now see multiple routes, multiple options for achieving net zero, with slightly different paths for each part of the UK, depending on the strengths in each part of the UK that they have. And it will involve, of course, a lot of change, but we are more and more reassured that there are really good, really strong, and especially cost-effective routes to achieving the necessary emissions reductions in every part of society. So let me say something about how we see that path to net zero playing out overall. And I'm just going to bring up some slides if I can, and hopefully you can see that. And this is the first thing I wanted to show you today. This is what we call our rainbow chart. Hopefully you can see why we call it that. And this is one of the most important things that we've produced recently. What this is showing you is, don't worry if this looks complicated, this is just showing you how we see emissions in the UK falling over the next 30 years. It will look similar for Scotland alone, but I'll come back to that later on. So imagine that we need to get from where we are today in 2020 on this chart, down that purple path that you can see along the bottom there to net zero. And the black line at the top, the thick black line that you can see, is what would happen in an imaginary world if we were to turn off all of the things that we're trying to do today to cut greenhouse gas emissions in the UK. So if we stopped doing those things today, we'd expect emissions to grow over the next 30 years. And what you can see is the colored stripes in between the purple line and the black line. And those are all the things that we need to do that we think we recommend, at least we should do, to get to net zero on that path. The bigger the size of the stripe, the bigger the emission savings that go with it. So broadly, achieving that purple path is about doing four things that you can see on the right there. The purpley stripes at the top are about reducing our use of things that lead to emissions in the first place. So that might be reducing our demand for carbon intensive things like flights or even red meat. And it could be about things like insulating homes, making them more comfortable with less energy use. So that's demand reduction and energy efficiency. The red, the orange, and the yellow stripes are about adopting low carbon technologies, which I know you've been talking a lot about. This is the electric cars that we're going to be driving, the heat pumps that we're going to be using to heat households, the hydrogen, the carbon capture as well that we might be using in industry. By far the biggest wedge there, hopefully you can see, is the orange one. That's all the electric technologies that are going to replace the fossil fuel technologies that we use today. In general, we see electrification as a really good approach, often the cheapest approach to decarbonizing in most cases. We also need low carbon fuels to run all those technologies. That's the blue stripe here. And that's us closing the last remaining fossil fuel power plants. It's also the low carbon hydrogen that we'll be producing in the future. And finally, the green stripe is the carbon that we're going to be storing in the natural world. So it's the trees and it's the soils, also the crops that we might be growing and then using to produce energy and hopefully capturing the carbon that's released when those crops burn. That green bit is the net in net zero. So it's us mopping up the residual emissions from farming and flying especially. Now, this chart shows you the path to net zero for the whole of the UK that we've just recommended. So getting to net zero by 2050. It also gets Scotland to net zero by 2045. But here's the thing. We haven't been able to model a way of getting to Scotland's 2030 target. That's because the 2030 target is so challenging. In the next 10 years or so, we're going to need to halve Scottish emissions, something that took us 30 years prior to that. So although we can't model that pathway, we have suggested a set of things that could be done to go even faster than the pathway I'm showing you here. It can be done in Scotland, I want to make that clear, but it's going to involve doing things in Scotland that aren't happening elsewhere in the UK. And there's a lot of uncertainty about how to do that. So potentially some of those things are going to be unpopular. The big three things that we've suggested to Scottish ministers are going faster to cut emissions from the Grangemouth industrial complex and the refinery there especially. Secondly, going faster to take away gas boilers in Scottish homes earlier than the rest of the UK. And thirdly, growing more of the bioenergy crops I talked about, using them to generate electricity and using that with carbon capture before 2030. That's quite a controversial proposal, but definitely something that Scotland has lots of potential to do. Those things would take you on a sharper fall in emissions than we are showing here and would help get to that 2030 target in Scotland. Now, because we have all this information, we can do something that we haven't previously been able to do, which is to show you what you need to invest to get to net zero overall. And hopefully you can see that here. And again, we're looking at something for the whole of the UK again, but I'm going to show you the Scottish chart in just a second. So this is all the investment that we need to see at UK level over the next 30 years. It amounts to about £50 billion of extra investment each year after 2030. So this is all the assets and the technologies that we are buying and investing in to get to net zero. Most of that investment we think would be private. That means it would be made by businesses and by people, by citizens. Some of it might be made by government, but the lion's share of it will be private investment. You can see, hopefully, that it's mainly about investing in five big things. So it's investing in the electricity system. That's all the wind farms we need. It's the transport system, the electric cars and the vans that we'll have. It's decarbonizing buildings. That's the home insulation and the low carbon heating that we'll be using, the heat pumps, the district heating and the hydrogen boilers. It's also the energy networks that support all of that change. And then this investment in decarbonizing manufacturing and construction too. And that's the size of the investment challenge. And it's a, you know, it's a big challenge overall. But the other cool thing that we can do with that information is we can look at what all those new low carbon assets do for consumers. So that's the bit under the line. And what I'm showing you here is really exciting. This is the saving to the economy from using all those low carbon technologies that I've just talked about. This is the UK not spending on fossil fuels. So we're using technologies especially that make use of cheap renewable electricity in the future. And over time, that saving actually cancels out the cost of the investments overall. So the other implication of this chart is that the overall cost, that's the net position of the cost of the investments and the savings that come from them. It means that the cost to the economy of net zero is much lower than we thought it was just a few years ago, thanks in particular to how quickly the price of offshore wind has fallen, which is going to be, we think, be the backbone of the energy system in the future. So the cost challenge we face is less, I think, about the overall cost to the economy, which is now very low, close to, well, rather under 1% of the GDP of the UK economy each year. It's really a challenge of achieving that in a fair way. So there are some things that will save us money. So the move to electric cars, we think, would save money versus a world where we keep driving petrol and diesel cars. And there are other things that are going to cost money, like the cost of decarbonizing heat and industry. We need to spread the costs and the benefits in such a way that we get a fair outcome. So we protect vulnerable people and companies for those costs that they can't afford to pay for. And I can show you the chart for Scotland. And this is the investment chart for Scotland alone that I'm showing you now. This is the really great to have this information. And it amounts to about £5 to £6 billion of extra investment in Scotland each year, again, after 2030. I haven't shown you here the equivalent saving to Scotland, because that depends largely on how much of this is paid for by Scottish consumers themselves and how much of it is spread across the UK. And that's a challenge that we'll have to see resolved over the next few years. So that's the kind of change that we need to see overall. And I just wanted to stop showing you slides now, if I can, and just give you a final few reflections on all of this. The main thing I wanted to say is that if we're going to get to net zero, the earlier we act, the better. And the Scottish target framework is going to help with that. So a few reflections on that. If we invest early, if we start acting more quickly, we're going to open up options later on for decarbonisation. That's going to really help, especially in case things don't go to plan. And occasionally things do not go to plan. Some things go better than we expect, and often things don't go quite as well as we thought. So acting early is an insurance policy against that. Secondly, that early investment is really a support to the economy as we recover from the effects of the pandemic that we are in right now. So think of all the jobs that will go with those big investments in energy and the environment that I've just talked about. Reducing emissions as quickly as possible also does one more thing, and that's minimizing the quantity of greenhouse gases that Scotland is adding to the atmosphere. So that's going to minimize Scotland's contribution to global warming. So again, the quicker we get down that path, the better. And my final point in all of this is not to talk so much about emissions, but to talk about the strategy overall. My final point is that I think we are often gripped by the what questions, if I can put it that way, the what would replace my gas boiler? What car will I drive? What industries will Scotland have in the future? But more and more, the what questions we have good answers to. So we know that there are a range of good solid answers to the questions of what technical fixes we need to get to net zero in each sector of the economy. The questions we don't have answers to are the how questions, if I can put it that way. How are we going to make a plan to decarbonize heat in every community in Scotland, every town in Scotland? How will we make big changes to industry? How will people be encouraged to change their patterns of consumption and the things that they buy? These, for me, are much more important now. And that's why you have such an important role in providing this advice that you are now working on to government and to ministers. I'm so pleased that the Scottish Government has an ambition to change things and has a big ambition to tackle net zero. But we're not going to get there just by wishing it. So we need to know, especially, what tougher aspects of a plan you might be willing to support? What would you be willing to stop doing? How much change do you think the government should be mandating on this path that lies ahead for Scotland? I would really encourage you to think hard about some of those difficult questions, as well as the things that we know need to be positively supported and subsidised. That's what's going to make this work that you're doing absolutely essential in framing up the steps that lie ahead. And I might just say, it's going to be absolutely brilliant for my work in advising on all of this if I can understand better what you would support, especially those difficult choices in the future. But the last thing I just wanted to say is thanks very much, and thanks for all of your hard work on this. It's really essential.